Well, here we go, Linda.
Here we go.
Here we go. I've been wanting to do this for so long, and I have been wanting to do this for so long, and now that I finally have you here, and have had an opportunity over the last 2 months to look at Linda's career extensively, although I've known her for years, I must say I have a keener appreciation of why so many people find her to be difficult. She started out in psychology and ended up getting a PhD in sociology, and then worked in counseling and vocational and IO psychology, and ended up in health psychology and evolutionary psychology. And, you know, Linda, I think before we get into your empirical contributions, why don't you just tell us a little bit about your journey? How did you start out in psychology and end up in sociology?
Well, I guess the first question would be how I started out in science, really. I was basically a farm girl. I consider myself a country girl because I grew up in what we called the country. Outside of a small town, we had wheat fields and corn and tomatoes and sorghum and all sugar beets, all sorts of things. My favorite activities were wandering the fields and collecting butterflies, insects, wildflowers, which is illegal now, I think, and wandering the dry river beds. My sibs and I played in the muddy irrigation ditches in the barns, and I loved it all. In high school and earlier, math was my very favorite subject. Science was a close second. My favorite readings, I read all the Nancy Drew books. I don't know if all of you know who that is, but it's mysteries for young girls to read, all of Sherlock Holmes. My favorite TV shows and books are still crime scene investigation and detectives and mystery stories and certain kinds of science fiction. So looking back as a vocational psychologist at one time, I can see my interests pretty clearly. At the time, I didn't know what I wanted to do and so on. I went to college in my hometown, Davis. Some of you may know, University of California, Davis, and majored in biology. Got married the next year, which was not so common these days, and we transferred to the University of California, Berkeley, where both of us became psychology majors. It was a wonderful place to do psychology. It was a crazy time politically and socially. Now, most of you are way too young to even think it's relevant to your lives, or it's ancient history, but it was, we had the long hot summers, as they were called. I see people nodding, which meant it was the height of the civil rights movement, but there was also a lot of race riots. I remember driving our motorcycle into a neighboring city to pick up my husband. The bus station and the city was burning. The Vietnam War protests were soon in progress. It was a crazy time, but it also helped stoke my interest in social inequality, which was always there anyway. So went into the Peace Corps then. Went in for 2 years, up for another year, in health. Ended up doing really epidemiology. Made my own job, it was wonderful. Trying to figure out why Malaysia had an infant death rate lower than Sweden's. Which of course, I don't know if everyone knows where Malaysia is, but just above Singapore, it's in Southeast Asia. The war in Thailand was on at the Vietnam War was on at the time. So it was a wonderful experience. Very hard. I mean, it's hard living in a really, really different culture where you don't understand hardly anything. And things are really different. But looking back, it did it was important or relevant to my later career in two ways. Living in a different culture, this was Asia. Well, they had Hindus, Malays, and a lot of Chinese. Okay? So it was very multicultural, as we would say. And the culture really were different. How you thought of parent-child relations, privacy, how much you earned, was it open, perfectly reasonable question to ask. Many things were different. And what Dad did partly was show me what my own culture was. Nothing like a big contrast with your own discipline or your own culture to see that they're different and what yours really was and who you really are or better, okay? The other thing was that I was about a foot taller, it seemed, than everybody else. And I was white. I was clearly different. I was always noticed. I could never go anywhere without being noticed and talked about in Malay, which I could understand enough to know they were talking about me, usually saying how tall I was. But I was also subject to all sorts of stereotypes. I had to be a representative of my culture. I was always asked about Hollywood. Did I know people in Hollywood? And because I was an American woman, I was a loose woman, and so I was approached more times than I would have cared to be. But most of all, I learned what it was like to be different and notice and never be able to escape being noticed, except when I was with my own kind, which was fellow Peace Corps volunteers. We felt so like we were anonymous when we landed in Great Britain afterwards. Oh, no one, we're completely inconspicuous. Of course, we wore funny clothes, we had this tan, but still, we were inconspicuous. So I have great sympathy for American blacks, among others, in what it means to be always on display and then criticized for wanting to be with your own kind. So those were two lessons that I learned in the Peace Corps. Then went to graduate school.
And why sociology, given that you started out in psychology?
Well, it was an era when I was a young girl growing up, no one had any expectations for me except to be a mother. And it continued for a while, but after the Peace Corps, my husband got accepted to Johns Hopkins University in the psychology department. I would have gone there, but he said, I'd really prefer you go to a different department. And I ended up in sociology, but it was actually, life isn't fair, but sometimes it turns out better, okay? And so please remember that. Sociology, as much as I don't respect the discipline anymore and criticize it, was a wonderful way to understand, well, sociology is very different than psychology. They think about what on the outside shapes us. We all want the same thing. We're all fungible psychologically. And the only difference is what happens to us. Okay? Psychologists sort of went the other way. Everything is internal, everything is choice, and didn't pay much attention to what was going on outside in people's lives and explaining, in this case, careers. But also the theoretical bent. And you can still see that today in social science, and it's as strong as ever, I think. Should point out is the word for individual differences in sociology is inequality, right? So we study individual differences. They're called disparities when you're dealing with group differences. So I was always very interested in those. And so that's how I actually got into vocational psychology.
And you actually developed a theory in vocational psychology because of your pursuit. How did you come about that? I
mean, fortuitous circumstances to some degree. John Holland happened to be at the university in my department, sociology, strangely enough, for circumstances. And I got interested in his work, and I was interested in trying to figure out why these two fields, both of which studied why people ended up in different occupations, had wildly different theories, and what did they mean by an occupation even? And so I set about trying to, I won't say translate them, but try to ferret out what were the conflicting assumptions of the two. And reminds me, at Yulia's talk, one of the things that she found unusual was that choice of occupation with educational level wasn't as heritable. Puzzle. Well, my theory was about that sort of thing. Why in the world would children or young people choose occupations that recreated the inequalities of the parent generation before they even were conscious of making a choice? And now, psychology didn't have any up and down dimension in terms of career choice. Sociology didn't have any sideways. So I set about melding the two, classifying occupations by both, seeing how they were related and distributed, and then how the both kinds of information about occupations shaped what children, as young as 2 and 3, thought about the world of work. And basically, and this is one of my major messages, a lot of things that I discovered were complete surprises. I had to break, set, change. It's not, everyone was studying occupational choice as what people most prefer. It's actually what, starting in very early childhood, people rule out as unacceptable for someone like themselves. So, girls were busy ruling out male jobs, and males ruling out female jobs, and so-called female jobs, and prestige was a very important thing. So we can talk about that later, because people have very common views of the world of work, which is very interesting. The same perceptions of jobs up and down, and we know from John Holland's work, same perceptions of jobs and different types of work. And say, if your parents think that being a firefighter or a carpenter is just great and you're bright, you may feel perfectly happy and it may be a great choice for you. But if you're the child of a professional and maybe you're not so bright, you're still going to be expected to aim high. And so I developed a theory on how this happened in very concrete terms. And by the time children get to adolescence, they've already basically, they're dealing with the remnants of choice. That's what I argue. Vocational psychologists are dealing with the remnants of choice by adolescence. So that was putting the two together.
And at what point did you start thinking that the G factor, or general intelligence, might be a more central dimension for organizing occupations than prestige?
Well, it depends whether you're dealing with the rewards or the requirements of jobs. If you're dealing with the rewards, and sociologists looked at them as boxes with, you know, trinkets hanging off of them, inside, what was inside didn't really matter. But if you're interested in why people do well, and are interested in those jobs, you've got to figure out what's inside.
Right.
Now, one of the things vocational psychology had started shunning the whole idea of abilities. Traditionally, it was abilities and interests, but they had shunned abilities because it was no longer what we would say now is politically correct. You could be pigeonholing people. But people told me, what do I do with these students? They're all aiming to be physicians and they're going to fail. What do? I can't tell them they're going to fail. And I dealt with that practical problem later. But so what do jobs require? If you're going to counsel kids, what do they require? There was no good data in the field. So that's when I started going out into employment psychology, personnel selection, job analysis, and I collected all the data sets that I could find that had anything to do with the requirements of work. And that was fun. I always liked dealing with large data sets. And I had for until then, patterns are so regular. It's not like psychological experiments, things bounce around. You know, you've got samples under a couple hundred. These were samples of thousands and tens of thousands, and you could see occupational aspirations trending very clearly. You could see other things. So it gave me a great appreciation of looking for trends. So it was actually a great time to be doing that because Schmidt and Hunter had just developed meta-analysis. You all listening to Yulia and others, Sharif, others this morning, oh, and Robert Plowman. All of that may seem old news to some of you. None of that, basically, very little of it was known, and maybe almost none of it accepted. I remember driving in the car in 1986, and I heard on the radio, I knew that a lot of things were heritable, certainly intelligence, but I heard on the radio, oh, researchers have discovered that depression might be partly heritable. Thank God they finally were able to talk about it. And now, everything we find is heritable. So I never expected intelligence. I went into science having no particular opinion of intelligence. In fact, I expected intelligence to be multiple. Different jobs, different abilities. But by golly, everything I studied tended to go in that direction. You know, the importance of G, the existence of G. And it's certainly the case in personnel selection. Once Schmidt and Hunter showed that if you took care of restriction of range, sampling error, and unreliability, the results started to fall in line. Before that, it was situational validity. Things could go up and down for this reason and that. You couldn't predict anything. Well, you can't with that kind of data. And I'd urge you all to, because a lot of people don't, but you probably do, pay attention to those three statistical artifacts. It makes so much difference in interpreting information. Really, so much difference. So don't get caught in the specificity trap.
Right. And that's fascinating because I think a lot of people, you know, want to know how that story developed, and a lot of people are aware of your contributions in vocational psychology and industrial psychology, but how did that evolve, if you pardon the expression, into evolutionary psychology and health psychology?
Okay, let me back up a bit. Okay. A lot of that work, I got involved in the industrial organizational debates because at that time, you couldn't discuss testing without discussing race and fairness. And that's when I became very interested in what I call the democratic dilemma. If you select more validly on important ability characteristics, you're going to have greater racial differences. If you try to equalize the races in terms of passing hiring tests, you're going to have loss of productivity and a lot of what some people would call unfairness. You can't have both at the same time. That's a common discussion in the philosophical, really, political literature. You can't have equality and excellence too. It's always a trade-off. So a lot of my work was dealing with those policy issues, and professional psychologists were trying to figure out why in the world can't they make a test that doesn't have disparate impact? So how did I get involved in those other things? Well, I guess I became an intelligence researcher as such, although I'd written on intelligence for some time, when Julian Stanley asked me to, or referred the American scholar to me for writing about what do we know about intelligence. So I actually had to read about it. I bought all the back issues of intelligence. I had to look into genetics, which I was doing anyway. When you're in intelligence and you get in the public eye at all, or you have to argue with anybody, you have to know something about everything. Everything. Okay? Genetics and social class. And so I was boning up on that. But then Murray and Herrnstein happened, their book. And Doug asked me to put together a special issue, because another thing about the field is it's so many misconceptions. I mean, mythologies, lies, misrepresentations, and it all sort of blossomed in this vivid manner with the publication of Herrnstein and Murray's book.
And people don't know that you're actually the person who introduced those two.
Yeah.
She's responsible.
Unintended consequences. Yeah, it was my husband, Bob Gordon, and I had put together a symposium for the American Psychological Association from two sociologists' perspective, because he's a real sociologist, and him on crime and me on employment. And we thought we'd get commentary. We had Raymond Cattell, we had Richard Herrnstein, who hadn't written about race, and we were talking about race, and we had Charles Murray, who talked about inequality but didn't consider individual differences. That's where they met and started collaborating, but we had dinner with Charles Murray and his wife, and Murray was arguing with us about, nah, can't be, you know? And I kept talking, and so did Bob. He began to look green around the gills. You know, he clearly understood that he was missing something very important. And so the rest is history. But an irony of this is that he and Richard Herrnstein were the butt of a lot of vitriol and hate and so on. At that time, I've been controversial, very controversial. We can talk about that later if you want. I was an absolute racist because I wrote about these group differences, and suddenly people were calling me, journalists, to be the other side of the debate, the knowledgeable person on the other side of the debate. So suddenly I was credible. That was really nice. So, but that was how that happened. But it led to putting together a special issue. Well, that I looked for someone to write about the practical, everyday meaning, the criterion-related meaning of intelligence. We deal in correlations and variances and percent of variances and so on, but that means absolutely nothing to the average person. They have no sense, and I think a lot of even scientists have absolutely no sense of the size of individual differences in intelligence or what people can and cannot do. I was at Oxford giving a talk on the practical meaning of intelligence, and I showed a slide with adult literacy test results, which is basically intelligence. Okay? And I showed them the slide, and some of them said, "Where'd you get that data? That can't be true." I showed things like they give simulated real things in everyday life, okay? Like totaling the price of two tickets for a Broadway show, say, or signing your name to a social security card, or you know, comparing the benefits of different kinds of programs. Well, it turns out, and this is all American adults, about a fifth of them can routinely do no more than simple things like find a date on something or sign a social security card in the right place. One bit of information, no distracting information, and literal, okay? One fifth. Okay, another 25 or 30 or so can at most routinely do items as complex as totaling the price of two show tickets. Now, you could teach people to do that, but life is full of these things every day. They keep changing on us, too. They're getting more complicated. And as I'll speak about, it's very important in health. Because health self-care is one of the most complex things in the world today, especially if you have chronic disease. So anyway, I think I've gotten off track there, but...
Let's talk about your two issues of journal vocational behavior, because that really set the stage for, you know, really your level of authority in the field and brought you to the place you were at where you could craft the letter to the Wall Street Journal when Herstein and Murray were under fire. So let's go back to those two special issues.
Personnel psychologists have become very concerned about the political and legal pressure on them to do things that they didn't think were right. And some of them knew about G. And so they asked a number of people, including Arthur Jensen. I think Jack Hunter was there. They asked me to speak about it. And I decided that this should be a special issue of a journal, because it wasn't going to get out otherwise. The journal I was associated with is in vocational psychology, but anyway, she accepted it. And then to get it out, my husband and I bought and mailed out 6,000 copies to major people in psychology. It was like instant knowledge, because you had, we got Lloyd Humphreys and Leona Tyler and Rich Arvey. Not all these names will mean anything to you, but they're very big in counseling or industrial psychology. And to comment, I mean, talk about the chutzpah. I just ask anybody, you know, and they actually respond. So it like changed, because all these people were authoritative. They all were giving this consistent message, and it was all published, and all these thousands of people got the copy. And overnight, G was a concept in the field, and people understood why they couldn't create tests that did away with disparate impact. So that was one of them. The next one was about fairness in testing, because the field was so wrought with legal problems, and employers were being sued for, it was prima facie evidence of discrimination if you didn't hire equal proportions of blacks and whites. Didn't matter why, you know, it was impossible to use tests for a while. Mm-hmm. So I wrote a lot about those problems.
That was in 86 and 88.
Yes.
And I remember when your first special issue came out, and Paul Meal read it and said, you know, we clinical psychologists, when I think of human abilities and vocational interests, we don't have to have as good as counseling and psychology. they were so compelling, and he cited your first special issue in his classic treatment of the statistical significance controversy. Look what psychology has to offer.
What's really remarkable about research involving intelligence is that it's so regular. By that I mean it's, now I put together a list once for a journal article on all the relations that were, that moderated the impact of G on performance and so on. For example, Mike McDaniel had done work on the role of experience. Does it, because people say, well, if you get experience, G doesn't matter. Not so. The value of experience after a couple of years washes away, and G becomes more important. As jobs are more complex, the differences are bigger. The more valid the test, the bigger the differences. Sort of the opposite of what everyone had hoped. And so that's really been a lot of my career since then, is finding all those regularities, partly to predict where and why G matters. That was the name of the article, Where and Why G Matters, to explain.
Right. And so your stature is on the rise in the field with respect to G. Bernstein and Murray come along and publish the bell curve and are immediately under fire, and then you craft the Wall Street Journal statement. How did that happen?
I think a lot of us in the field were distressed by the total misinformation, misrepresentation of the field of intelligence. Most of it was considered pseudoscience. We were pseudoscientists. Everyone knew that it either didn't exist, couldn't be measured fairly. Even if it could, it didn't matter. If it mattered, it was malleable. You know, all different people were saying different things, but they all added up to a big crescendo of criticism. And then when it came to race, there's no such thing as race. Well, yes, there is, but so it goes on. And then finally, you can't talk about it. Okay, and some people were writing very explicitly. It's basically your moral duty not to talk about it. And you were treated as if there was something peculiar in your character if you did. Okay? So that's, many of us were concerned, many of you in the room. And so I thought I'd write a letter to the editor of this Wall Street Journal, and the editor, David Brooks, said, was a friend of Murray, I guess, said, no, but why don't you put together a few findings and have a few people sign it? And you got 2 weeks. So I wrote something. It was really easy to write, 25 points. Got suggestions for names of people, and I looked through my list who were not just respectable, but renowned. And faxed them. We didn't have email or anything like that then still. It was in 1994. And 100 people, and 50 of them, they couldn't change a word. Can you imagine that? Couldn't change a word. Because I wasn't going to dicker over it. And it was basic. It was simple stuff. You know, tested reliable. But it did mention the race differences. And 50 people besides myself signed it. And I turned it in to David Brooks, and he said, this isn't wimpy at all. I mean, this was a big shock. All the basic stuff in our field. Just taken for granted. He took it for granted. So he published it. And he didn't expect 50 people to sign it either. And thank you for... A number of you were signers. Some people couldn't because it was hazardous to your professional health. If, you know, people who didn't have academic positions, people who were administrators, things like that. But many people did. And I gather there were cheers in some academic departments when it came out. Charles Murray offered to buy me a luxury car, which he reneged on. So, yeah, that was an effort to try to protect the science. What was really interesting is that there was no criticism of it that I know of. That was really interesting. It's not that people, everyone accepted it, but they didn't know what to do with it. So I just ignored it. But anyway, that was a happy outcome.
Yeah, there was a conspicuous silence at the time. And then you, not so long after that, were either, did Doug Detterman ask you to do a special issue on intelligence?
Yes, it was specified that this statement, mainstream science on intelligence, would be an editorial in that special issue, and I explained exactly how it came about, the reasons people gave, if they gave them, for not signing, how many people, how they were chosen. It was like a research project, mm-hmm. explained, and a bibliography, people wanted to read more. And again, John Carroll, Robert Plowman, and Petrell. David Rowe, who spoke about bringing genetics to the table, spoke about genetic differences by race in achievement. There was David Lubinski and Lloyd Humphreys, myself, and Robert Gordon. As I say, I tried to find someone to write the paper I wrote, and there was no one out there I could find who could tell me what the external meaning was of different IQ levels. So I went and collected a lot of stuff from here and there and, you know, tried to pin IQ levels to recruitment ranges of occupations and so on, which I'll talk about tomorrow.
That was a powerful special issue.
Yeah, and then... We sent 6,000 copies of that around, too. To journalists, too.
You like that number, 6,000.
Well, yeah, it's sort of what we could get money for.
I see. Okay, now we're at a...
You can't ask for too much, yeah.
Now we're at a point you have really firmed up your status and authority on intellectual functioning and general intelligence. How did your empirical work in health psychology and evolutionary psychology begin? Was it in tandem, parallel?
Well, all of these things overlap. You know, I didn't stop one day doing vocational and then the next day do. They were all, the next thing I did was always informed by what I had done before. It's like pulling a thread on a sweater, you know, or a trail. You know, like a detective on a trail. I was following a trail and asking questions. And for the paper on the last one we talked about just now, why G matters, intelligence in everyday life. And I should point out, I'm grateful to Robert Gordon. There's some heuristics that are very helpful. Treating everyday life as an intelligence test is very useful because you look at its psychometric properties. Okay? Of course, it's not as reliable, may not be as valid. People segregate themselves, but it helps you understand where and why it matters or doesn't, and how people can say, well, it doesn't matter here, it doesn't matter there, but you can begin to predict, and especially if you know the complexity. That's really one of the messages I want to leave you with, is that to understand intelligence and effects in everyday life, you have to understand what brings it forth. That's what an ability is. The stimuli, class of stimuli, that bring forth individual differences in that content arena. In this case, with G, there is no content, which makes it so remarkable. Any kind of content. So it's called domain general. Okay, and we'll come to that when I talk about evolution. But intelligence in everyday life is a test. Okay, the next one I'll talk about is health self-care is a job. Okay, a very useful heuristic. I'd studied all these characteristics of jobs and had discovered, quite to my shock, putting together the special issue in 1997, that your own primary health care provider. I thought my doctor took care of my health.
No.
because the real issue is prevention. Same with accidents, which I read a lot about. And here's another flip. It's not what causes accidents, it's what prevents them. And what prevents them is a highly cognitive process. And so is preventing or ameliorating chronic diseases. Okay? And if you look at something like diabetes, which I'm very involved in now with a diabetes educator, it is very much like a job. A job is simply a constellation of tasks and activities that you have to carry out for a purpose. And they evolve over time. And for diabetes self-care, it's a 24/7 job with no days off, no vacations, no pay, and virtually no training. But it'll kill you easily, eventually, if you don't take proper care of yourself. Sometimes you can't control it, but you can do a lot. And one of the major problems in health, despite all our technology and greater access today, is what they call non-adherence to treatment. Okay. It is the bane of healthcare providers' existence. The non-compliance with treatment plans, even taking prescriptions or getting them filled, or is just mind-boggling. It's a huge waste of money, one thing. It leads to unnecessary hospitalizations, a lot of worsening of chronic disease, high health costs, high personal costs. With diabetes, you can lose your leg, and many people end up, not many, but a fairly number, are blind, or heart attacks, because it's really a heart disease in a way. A sludge. That sugary blood is like sludge going through your body. But you have to conceptualize that to take it seriously. And like a lot of chronic diseases, you have to understand what's going on inside. And it doesn't really seem to make much difference if you eat, 10 donuts that day. It's going to take a while for it to really hurt you in the long run. So people don't see a noticeable difference. There are a lot of problems. So I'm in the midst of trying to analyze the tasks in self-care according to their complexity and how you can reduce unnecessary complexity. If you read a lot of the health ed literature or the things that are handed out to you by the doctor, oh my goodness. Electronic health records is spitting out this health education material and reports that are undecipherable. Sometimes there are pages and pages. It's totally undecipherable. And medicine is not as scientific as you might imagine. Certainly not when it comes to intelligence. Physicians apparently aren't taught about individual differences. They're under fire when there's disparities in outcomes. They're sent for cultural re-education or cultural sensitivity training. Blame, 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 as Julia was saying. Everyone's blaming everybody else. You blame the teacher, you blame the physician, you blame this, you blame that. And so anyway, that's how I got into health. And there's a rhetorical advantage if you want to look at it this way. If you don't pay attention to individual differences in ability, which, and this non-compliance is by G, they call it literacy, but they mean something very different. people die. This is unpleasant consequences, and people die prematurely. And it's expensive while they do it. And it's for the system, and it's very unpleasant. So instead of talking about privileges for the elites, which is what social privilege theory of sociologists do, I talk about functional theory. These things really matter. These people of low ability, lower ability, are suffering because of a refusal, in my view, to look at individual differences. It's touchy there too. There are health literacy researchers who know the story. They know it's intelligence, but they've told me that I can't say so because I'll lose my funding. So in the meantime, the field is fallen into the specificity morass. Now there's suddenly different kinds of literacy. You've got numerical literacy, verbal literacy, you name it. And because they use unreliable measures, of course they aren't correlated, so we have all these different ones, right? So, and the poor diabetes educators, among others, who deal with patients, you know, it's hard to know what to do. They're told to improve self-efficacy. Really, people have made money on a program at Stanford raising self-efficacy. Anyway, no more editorial on that, but I think there's a lot of practical mileage and social benefit to looking at how the increasing complexity of everyday life, especially in healthcare, which is getting more technological and complicated. Before, you had a heart attack, they'd send you home maybe with an aspirin and say good luck, okay, in the 60s. Now you go on regimens of this and that, and medications and diets and exercise. It's very different. So what happens is that the brighter people are better able to exploit this new information. And what you see, first law of individual differences, is that disparities increase. Like happened in Great Britain when they put in universal health care. It didn't get away, didn't do away with inequalities. It increased them. That's what happens in school systems. You equalize access, you equalize quality, the differences increase. It's perverse for many people, but that's what you expect. But as the mean goes up, you don't, when the mean goes up, the variance doesn't decrease in where G matters. So that's an exacerbation of the democratic dilemma.
And you know, it's really interesting because when I think of your contributions to the world of work, you've shown so clearly how G is the central parameter to what was historically called prestige. And then, in health psychology, you've shown that G is a more central covariate than the SES gradient. There's this whole SES gradient.
It's amazing. There are so many phenomena out there that we struggle with that we call social inequality that are really parallel in many ways. And when you look at it, you're really looking at the operation of this biological fact about the human species, that we differ biologically generation after generation in a replicable way in general mental ability, that is the ability to think abstractly, solve problems, not connected to any particular content. It's general for that reason. It's domain general. So, I forgot where I was going with that.
Well,
you can put me on track.
I think the SES gradient.
Oh, yes. Thank you. One thing that health sociologists have found, and it puzzles them greatly, is what they call the mystery or the fundamental cause. Because what they call disparities in health, they are regular. They run through absolutely, but virtually all conditions, virtually all societies, all health systems. It's linear. At a certain point, enough money should be enough to get good health care, but you find that it still goes up. And so they're trying to figure out what in the world is it. It must be something psychological or stress under the skin or something. But it doesn't fit any of their theories. They can't explain it with social class, they can't explain it with money or access. Well, I think it's cognitive access. And that's really the issue in health care. You've got to provide cognitive access, and people differ in their ability to take advantage of that. And so I argued, using various kinds of data, a sort of what I do is I collect data that other people have collected, and trends and meta-analyses, and do some of my own, small analyses, but like pick up all sorts of stuff from different disciplines and see whether it meshes or not, to test the theories. And so, for example, they don't measure intelligence, right? Because it's not important. So you can look at functional equivalence. Which ones are better equivalents? Well, think about it. Among education, occupation, and income, which is the best equivalent if you had to pick one for G? Education. Next, occupation, then income, which is not, it's a mild correlation. 2, 3, 3 by adulthood. Well, you find when you, because those measures are readily available in some data sets, if you look at those variables and look at their relation to the disparities, guess what? I can see from the smiles you know what the answer is. The disparities are bigger when you got more G-loaded surrogates for G. And so that kind of information, and and it also brings in my accident research, because this is another important point I want to make. Accidents are a major cause of death still, around the world. Accidents, it's not what causes accidents, as I said, it's what prevents them. And so that paper also talked about how it was a cognitive process, which applies to preventing cognitive diseases as well. But this underlies, caring for yourself, especially in a more complex world, is G-loaded. Not all the items are G-loaded, but if you do it day after day after day after day, what does the Spearman Brown prophecy formula tell you? It accumulates, right? So no one measure of blood pressure or whatever, which I've seen correlates with intelligence, because I think intelligence doesn't matter. It's like the grade point average. It builds and it builds and it builds. Compound interest. So those small effects really add up. And so that's part of the argument for caring for one's health. You don't just jump in at the end and change something. It's just a lot of little things.
Yeah, and I think this takes us to a good point to move into evolution now. But before we do, I think your most powerful article on this topic is your JPS piece in 2004, which appeared in a very conspicuous special issue
of yours
on the 100-year anniversary of Spearman's discovery of G. And I know you won the George A. Miller Award for that piece, Outstanding Article in General Psychology from APA Division I. I know people know about it. Health psychologists go to JPSD for their basic science. Any feedback from them?
Not
hard to believe they all haven't seen it.
I want to go back and look at the literature in response to that article. Because I know that there was a lot of skepticism at the time, because people were not looking at it at the population or epidemiological level. They were looking at it at the individual level, saying, well, intelligence doesn't predict everything. But that wasn't the point. When you aggregate over populations, events, or time, the Spearman-Brown formula works equally well. So, with accidents, no one of them has been found to correlate with intelligence. But if you look at the patterns of accidents, now I don't have G data on that, and it depends on your age and sex, but you can see trends that are very striking when you look at, say, different levels of neighborhoods in terms of income and their likelihood of things like being struck by lightning, a child being run over in the driveway, neglect, things that are dying in a fire, a lot of things that you might not expect have anything to do with social class. But again, it's all prevention. So when you aggregate, over kinds of accidents and stuff within reason, you can get really stable, interesting patterns. Evolution?
Yeah.
This was an interesting one. I thought I was invited to write a chapter in a book on domain general versus domain specific ability or intelligence. Because a lot of evolutionary psychologists and others argue that intelligence is domain specific. It's a module. Okay? Or it's social. Okay? And how big your group is. Because then you need to memorize more things or something. And I'm not saying mating doesn't matter or anything like that, but a lot of tool use. It cannot be tool use that led to the acceleration of brain size in humans, because tool production came after it started. Now that was a real problem for me, because I was going to explain this with the complexity, right? World was more complex, so that drove up. What it does is it picks off people at the bottom, right? Evolution, that's what it does, whatever the trait. Picks off a few people now and then from the bottom of whatever dimension it is. And the correlations are minuscule or inconspicuous, right? So you don't notice, at least with accidents. And so what could it be? It's general. What specifically an environment could produce or evolve a general intelligence? And it had to have evolved. How in the world did it evolve? And I struggled, and I read, and it took months, and felt like years, probably was. And then again, it's simpler, Linda, it's simpler in the sense that what's distinctive about us, really? We have a great mind's eye. What does a mind's eye mean? We can see something that's not in front of us. We can imagine something in the future or somewhere else. Animals, to my knowledge, don't have much of that, not as much as we do. So if you look around this room or anywhere outside, the place is filled with hazards, right? And we protect ourselves against them, but animal bites and falling out of trees and stuff like that were common among, stepping on snakes, getting lost in the forest among some pre-technological societies. And apparently, anthropologists who go through the jungle looking up in the trees also get bit by snakes, not just hunters with their new bows and arrows, as happened in the Aceh. So, falls, drowning, there's a lot of hazards. And the trick, so it's sort of a Darwin Awards theory, but without the implication that this is really stupid, because accidents aren't accidental. Maybe much of it is chance, but there's always a possibility of some prevention. And so not looking ahead in some way, fire dining. Fires is a big problem in some countries still, burning. So basically that was the argument, and it was Spearman Brown writ large. Over many, many generations and many kinds of risks. So it's really helpful to have a puzzle like that, that you just keep gnawing at. You know, if you have this nomological network developing, the web of evidence and regularities, it constrains what you can theorize or how you can explain something. And so that's partly what I've done, is to try to constrain myself by looking widely, and done that with social privilege theory and so on. But if you know a lot of the data, you just can't consider certain sorts of explanations, and then you're left with, what in the world do I have left? And this is one of those circumstances. But it's also what I told you, I like to read detective stories, right? Loved it, still do. And so it's the pursuit that is so fascinating. And the rewards when something clicks, like sociologists said intelligence could not predict job performance. Because they knew it because education predicted the job you got, how high it was. Intelligence did not. Education did not predict performance on the job, therefore intelligence couldn't possibly. So trying to figure that out, you know, it dawned on me one day, people get hired on the basis of education because employers think it's important. Not because it is necessarily, but it probably is. I call it a valid but fallible indicator of intelligence. And so as long as it works reasonably well, they'll do it. It doesn't mean it explains how well people do in the job. And it became illegal to use intelligence about in the 70s. So things, moments like that, like the aha, oh my God, I can move forward now, are just really wonderful. Really wonderful. It's hard. It's hard. You gnaw at it, and you gnaw at it, and you gnaw at it. You read some more. No, that's not it. But it's an amazing job. I feel very lucky to have it. So anyway.
you've made so much progress in a lot of these various domains we've talked about. What do you see as the big questions?
There are a lot of big questions, and a number of you are dealing with them. You know, what are the genes? What are the brain processes? But I'm interested in one that I don't think is being examined, and it's sort of the flip side of intelligence, and that's what brings it out. What, and it can be very useful, I think, in studying brain processes, for example, or anything else having to do with the brain. If you have a good idea, if you had a classification, say, of the stimuli that you could characterize by different elements of complexity, and you could even build it up, and there's some evidence on that, but at very different levels of analysis, you know, job analysis, task analysis, item analysis, and I envision these, what I call them, gradients of effect. If you could look at the landscape out there, in the social world, the economic world, and see these rises of complexity and the falls and the changes over time and where in life you have the steepest and the narrowest and how people deal with them, you'd learn a lot about why and where G matters. And I think it would help also in the brain because, and it would, I've written recently that it would also help unite experimental and differential psychology, because you use the same, we use the same task for, in many ways, and we both sides know that complexity matters, but if you had a metric, you could even compare, you know, effect sizes in one versus the other. Anyway, I think that there is a lot of conceptual, theoretical, methodological promise in paying attention to what makes intelligence important, what brings it out, the stimuli. And I've been frustrated. You know, I've looked around for such things and nothing, there's some good things at different levels of analysis like the adult literacy. They find the same process, lack of, you know, how much distracting information, how many bits of information, and the inferences you have to draw, you know, stuff like that. But that's too gross for some things. It helps, you know, different levels of tasks and jobs. We know a lot, I put a lot together, about what makes jobs complex, okay? So I think that's one thing. It would help me.
Yeah. What do you consider your most significant contribution?
Well, probably the most influential, I don't know, because people don't write me and tell me about it, but so much, is the Why G Matters paper, because it provided a concrete feel for how much G matters, or the practical consequences. What kinds of jobs, what are the recruitment ranges in the IQ distribution for different jobs? What are the kinds of education that are generally found useful at different ranges? Mm-hmm. The odds of, and you can look at the odds of different kinds of social outcomes, from income to being in a profession to being in poverty to being out of work. And you can calculate odds ratios. And so it's just brings it to life. And also explaining that it's the ability to deal with complexity and show how it works in everyday life with specific things. Journalists would call me. And I'd start talking about, well, it's like your job, right? And talk about drawing inferences and relevance and so on. Oh, yeah. Now, I flattered them too, but they got a better sense. Or if you have a chronic disease, they go through it. So I think that has helped. I don't think it's the most theoretically innovative.
We're talking
about the YG Matters.
We're talking about your contribution to the special issue of intelligence that
yeah.
you guest edited
yeah.
in 1997. Just yeah. so people know. But you're saying that's not your most...
Well, I'd say that's the most influential.
Uh-huh.
I'd have to think about which other ones was my favorite or the hardest.
Or what are you proudest of?
What am I proudest of? Standing up for scientific integrity and for the rights of students and faculty and other scientists whose views are often suppressed or threatened. I've been involved in quite a few controversies, and one of the things I've done is try to be a participant observer. How do these things work themselves out? How do they evolve? What are the social processes that are involved? Shunning is certainly one. Okay, and so it's interesting. You know, it's annoying at the time, but if you step back, it's sociologically, psychologically fascinating. And it's crowd behavior, and it's what we call a feeding frenzy. Once someone attacked you, and it could be a feeding frenzy, and friends turned on you, they wouldn't talk to you, other people came that you didn't even know that defended you. They spent their summer, or one grounds worker scared my secretary at first, this sort of rumpled guy walks in with something behind his back. This is during the height of a 3-year controversy where I needed a lawyer for 3 years. The sweet man did it pro bono because he was so angry at political correctness. And so he comes to my door and he whips it out. What is it? A single red rose. And he says, thank you, and walks away. You know, every once in a while you get these kinds of responses, and I've gotten various kinds of responses. They're not all that public, but they're so rewarding. And you know you've made a difference in for people.
Right, it's a nice example. Linda, looking back, do you have any noteworthy professional regrets?
I have thought about that for a long time, and I can't think of any except I don't have enough time. Really, not enough time.
Yeah.
I got the patience, the willingness, I don't have the time.
Yeah. Linda, who influenced you the most? Who do you look to? And
okay, I'll answer it. If there's one person I had to pick as someone I really admired for their scientific brilliance and scientific integrity, it would be Arthur Jensen. I think he's responsible for much of our validating evidence on G. He was very systematic. He would answer all the questions. Is it, do we have the same G's? I mean, there are a whole lot of things. And he was experimentally very clever, in ways that I never could be. But he had a breadth of view. And he was interested in nothing but the science. I mean, as Doug, I think, said once, he didn't have a political bone in his body, even though it was said, or something like that, even though it was said he must be biased, he must be pseudoscientific, and so on. So I admired him greatly, and to get praise from someone like that means a lot, you know? And there are others. And a number of you are in this room. But I should also say I'm extraordinarily grateful to people who helped along the way. The first were Julian Stanley. He was in the psychology department at Hopkins, and a wonderful man. I'm a southern gentleman, and he would read all my papers. He'd send me stuff. He was, in a way, my sociologist husband's best friend. I mean, it was Bob's best friend. And Julian's the one who got him interested in IQ, because Bob didn't think it was much of anything either. Julian sat him down at lunch one day at the faculty club. That was that. You know, sort of like Charles Murray. Mm-hmm. And then other people who've written on my behalf, who've just been great friends, many of whom have experienced many of the same things. So I'm just extremely grateful. And that includes you, David.
You know, Linda, there are a lot of graduate students, postdocs, young faculty members in the crowd, and this is going to be on the internet, so they're going to be listening to you, those who aren't even here. They'd like to have your advice. What would you advise the young academic starting out? I mean, they look at all of your contributions and they just say, wow, what do you have to do to develop a career like this?
Well, everyone, there are individual differences, okay? And this isn't for everyone. But what I would have to say are several things. One is, don't try to take shortcuts. By that I mean, I've seen some people do something popular or quick, you know, a bandwagon they jump on, and they're popular or lauded for a while. It doesn't last. You want to do something that really is interesting to you, it grabs you, you're passionate about, and that you dig deep into. Okay? You really, so don't try to take shortcuts. They can boomerang on you too. Another I already mentioned. Life isn't fair. Why would you expect it to be? I mean, you rail at it when it's not, but you just move on. You might try to predict some of them, but I wouldn't waste my time too much. There are opportunities. Remember gene environment interactions? I sometimes confuse them, but you know, niche seeking, niche creation. You can always improve your niche. You can always make a bigger difference than you realize. Someone asked me in one of the questions, how do you get sociologists to believe in intelligence? Well, you could say that about a lot of psychologists too, and English professors and journalists and others. My answer is one at a time. Now that sounds impossible, but Charles Murray, Joanne Stanley, and Bob had to convince me, right? And scientific revolutions, as you've probably read, are often partly the young or the new replacing the old, because they have a vested interest in sometimes the wrong answer. But hang in there and find your opportunities. I was fired from a job at Hopkins because I probably threatened their grant. It was a big institutional grant. And you don't talk about intelligence if you have a grant for educational equality, especially racial equality from the federal government. So, but I ended up in an academic position where I could do what I wanted. Not with the grant monitor, though. I didn't have to do it on the side all the time. So there, I'm going on too much about that, but really do think about that. There, make your opportunities to the extent you can, and there's always some way to improve your situation.
Well, you didn't tell the complete boomerang effect of that. The Hopkins ended up giving you their Distinguished Scholar Award.
Different part of the institution.
Oh.
My boss had earlier told the public relations office not to put out our press release on the symposium at which Bernstein and Murray would appear. They refused. It wasn't the sort of thing that Johns Hopkins, according to the press office, instigated by my boss, perhaps because of the funding issue, would do. So yeah, that was a special pleasure. And I also got fellow in, I think, three organizations for the very work that I was under fire at my university for so many years, where they also tried to fire me and cut off my research funding and did all sorts of other things. They lost in the end. And were mildly embarrassed in the end, but yeah.
one more question. Any advice?
Oh, yes. One more thing I wanted to say.
Okay.
And I only realize this is to the women in the audience. One thing that your own research shows is that women are more community-minded, they're more helpers, they're less focused, intensely focused on their career than men are. It's often said that it's socialization. However, I was always, male colleagues would say, why are you doing that, Linda? That's wasting your time, some sort of service activity. And I realized one day, standing there, that I had a physiological reaction to saying no. I think that's built into us. You men, probably not many of you would know that, but it's like, I've heard this about parenting too. Women will do things that fathers won't because fathers don't think it's that risky or important. But the mothers, it's like a biological imperative. But it took me, I don't know how many decades, most of my life, to even recognize it. Not that I can control it, but so just watch for it because people can take advantage of you. You know, aren't you going to help? You know, the guilt syndrome. The guys aren't doing it, so someone needs to. You can ask me about it if you want, but that's it. That's okay.
Well, Linda, I think that's a nice place to end in the formal interview. At this point, we turn it over to the audience. Because I'm sure there are a lot of questions out there for you.
And you can ask me questions anytime, and I would encourage the younger people here to approach the more senior people and ask questions. I love it. And frankly, we're approachable, most of us, I assume. All of us. I mean, that's one of the pride we have in ISIR is that it's the interaction with younger people in the field, or more junior, I don't know how to put it, but you're our colleagues, okay? So I tell my students, don't be afraid to ask stupid questions. They're often the best, most basic, most profound. That other people are afraid to ask because they sound stupid, but they're not. You're like, why? Okay. Why this? Why that? Okay. I'd love it.
Well, this has been a pleasure, Linda. Thanks so much.
It's been a pleasure for me, David.
Okay. Thank you.
ISIR is my home.
Thanks, that's been an inspiration to see what you've done for the field to correct errors, very common errors, in many other fields of science. So, are you optimistic about the future? Will educators, for instance, embrace research in our field in 10 years? What do you think?
Well, I can tell you a reaction I had to the talks this morning. None of that was known. No one. I don't know if people would have predicted it, or I would have hoped for it. Okay? And a lot of what you talked about this morning is taken for granted in some parts of science, not as many as we would like. Okay? But enormous progress has been made since I started out. It was a wasteland, not a wasteland, there was a lot known, okay? But it was dominated by misconceptions and people weren't very confident. I mean, we're still arguing whether tests were biased.
Some people still argue they are, but it's not scientific. Now, I think education is a special case in that I used to teach, well, I am in a department of education. I used to teach pre-teachers. And I work with people who are in education, and what I've observed, and I was working in an educational research center, there is great antipathy to differences in intelligence because schools are supposed to be the great equalizer. And school psychologists, except for two in my department, they use intelligence tests in order to read the tea leaves of specific differences. I'm lectured on, I should believe in multiple intelligences. What do you mean there's general intelligence? So education, and it's very politically dominated. I mean, it's become more and more a government run enterprise. And when you get politicians involved, it's a different ball game. I don't know that I can answer you really, except that that's going to be a really hard one. I can tell you that in personnel selection, there was a lot of progress. Some of the standards got changed to allow what's called validity generalization. You didn't have to repeat a validation study on every little sample, which would be nonsense anyway now, we know. People can once again use tests if they jump certain hoops, which I think are often overly demanding, but they've learned how to jump the hoops. They've done the research. So I think it's very, it's different in different policy arenas. I'm hoping to make a difference in health because people die there and practitioners are desperate for something to do. I don't know. Right now I'm an army of one plus my colleague who I've converted. But she's not a scientist. That's a real interesting challenge to communicate to a profession that is run by standards, okay? Not scientific standards, but practice standards, regardless of their, and you don't question them. So I can't say certain things when I'm with her, because she's so nervous about the bureaucracy coming after her. I think she's overly concerned, but and maybe I'm not concerned enough. But, so it's a different kind of animal when you're dealing when there's a lot of standards and there's reluctance and immense ignorance and an industry that's, well, that's enough said. What do you think?
Well, it is a major challenge because there are so many topics related to intelligence, and the major challenge that we have as a field is to translate what we do to other fields.
Yes.
And also to communicate the vast amount of research that has been done for the last 100 years in a very simple way.
Yes, I agree completely with that. And that's been one thing that I've been concerned about throughout my career is how to do that. Part of it's getting around some of the gatekeepers by sending things out directly, by writing op-ed pieces. I wrote two op-ed pieces when I came across scandals. This is in the Wall Street Journal. One was a blue ribbon panel of the National Academy of Sciences in the United States recommended that we race norm tests in hiring. And it was going to become the law because the Civil Rights Act has had someone had sneaked some of that language in there. And I thought it was scientific malpractice. So did others. And so talking to my fellows wasn't going to make much difference. So I wrote a piece in the Wall Street Journal that they titled, "When Fairness is Nothing But a When Job Fairness is Nothing But a Quota." That got the attention of people. And in the end, the Civil Rights Act in progress banned race norming. Okay? So sometimes you can change policy, and that was important. What happened then was that when employment psychologists were deprived of race norming, which was started by the US government, it was part of its practice, and it was under question in their, they tested people with the GAPI, the General Aptitude Test Battery, for employers and then referred them. But to avoid disparate impact, they routinely raised the scores of black applicants so they would equal whites, and same with Hispanics. The next thing that happened was that when you couldn't have double standards, there were people in the field who went to no standards, no cognitive standards. That was the next Wall Street Journal piece I wrote. I see some people here who were, yes, involved.
The police force?
Yeah, what was happening is that in order to get enough minority police officers, nothing that had been done before worked. One district or jurisdiction in New York, Nassau County, had continued to improve their tests. What happens when you increase the validity of a selection test? It doesn't induce disparate impact. So they kept being sued over and over again by the Justice Department. So the solution was the Justice Department teamed up with some eminent industrial psychologists, big, big names, past presidents of the organization, and proceeded to produce a innovative, state-of-the-art test that, voila, virtually did away with disparate impact while improving validity. Well, if you know anything about G, you know there's something wrong with that. Okay? It can't happen. It just empirically won't happen. They found the Holy Grail, which everyone was searching for. So I only learned about it because someone in the field gave me a copy of their technical report, which is about this thick, with all the names blacked out, so I didn't know who it was. And I went through it. It took months of study. And it turned out, well, what they had done is they had created this innovative experimental battery of, I don't know, a lot of things. They had video stimuli, they had a lot of personality tests, you know, all innovative. Which the personality tests happened to be owned by a number of the developers. So the US government was going to promote this test and push it on all the police jurisdictions in the United States. Well, they tested 30,000 men. I think it was in, what's the big stadium in New York? They got the test results, and then they decided which tests to keep. The only cognitive test that they retained was reading at the first percentile. That's nothing. And in fact, I was called by one of the union people because they were selecting not lawyers who often apply because it paid so well, but people with really shady histories. It made no sense. They were hard to train, took longer to train. So they, what we called, gerrymandered the test. But then their job was to cover it up. And they did that in a number of ways. And so I wouldn't bore you with it now, but you know, the different kinds of statistics they calculated and so on. And there was a huge to-do about that. Some people wouldn't talk to me again for a while. Said I was unethical for putting it in the Wall Street Journal first. But I knew if I tried to publish it, I even breathed it, I'd be discredited. I mean, what am I compared to these four or five past presidents and very famous people? So, so there was a huge, I won't call it a symposium, but at the next meeting of the Society of Industrial and Occupational Psychology, there was a symposium where the developers and I were to debate. Most of them and one of me. Okay? So I said, well, at least let Frank Schmidt speak from the audience, take him first. They didn't. It was standing room only. I mean, it was quite an event. And one of the people who was responsible for this report was afraid to show up to get his award for something else. So it was the scandal itself killed the test because they had to answer for it. Now, I have no illusions that the same thing hasn't been done again, because there were people waiting in the wings to provide the test that would work. Okay? But I don't think it's one that was pressed on all the police departments.
I think we should wrap up.
Yeah, you guys can leave. We can talk outside. AJ.
Like
I hope they keep the hors d'oeuvres for us.
Last question.
Okay.
Here.
Like David, I'm going to kind of bring you back to evolution, as you probably know I was going to. Now, as you know, a lot of silly things have been said about human evolution being over because we've eliminated
natural Oh, heavens,
survival,
no.
Because we've made the world such a wonderful place and nothing ever happens to people. Now, I know that that's silly, but what I'm going to ask you is slightly different. I know that your answer is going to be no to that, but you've been analyzing implicitly, even though you may not have put it that way, patterns of what contemporary selection is
yes.
like.
Yes.
What is being selected against, specifically. You know, when you have a lot of information from accidents, from healthcare consequences, whatever, do you have any insight from that as where the evolution of human intelligence is going? Because selection is what makes it happen, right? So from these patterns of selection you're seeing, do you have any insight as to what our intelligence is going to be in the future?
I'm not sure that process is still operating, because we do a lot to protect people from accidents, but probably more importantly, we're keeping people alive. And we complain about the inequalities that that complexity creates, like health disparities. It's a major political issue. So if anything, it's generating a lot of political turmoil. I don't know about the selection involved, but we, like many societies, are committed to supporting the most, quote, downtrodden, the least capable. I mean, that's part of the ethic. And in fact, I've been criticized by one person. Why would you want to save the low end of the bell curve with your health education? Okay. So I don't know that it's a positive selection anymore.
Okay.
I really don't.
I think we should probably wrap it up.
He's telling me to stop.
Thank you, Linda.
Thanks, Dave. Time to eat. Time to eat. Oh, you are my wonderful family. Thank you.